I'm Rhys Jones.
And I'm Tom Solstad.
And this is Beyond Horizons in a Kayak. So let's start a podcast, Thomas, with a kreiso.
Hjärtligt välkommen.
Witam serdecznie from Poland.
Welcome to all of you.
To all our listeners out there, exactly. Today's podcast is on reasons to be cheerful. Yes, we've actually found enough reasons to be cheerful to fill a whole pod, possibly, Thomas, two. We'll see how we get on today.
Oh, yeah.
So surely the first reason to be cheerful is that we have a new podcast to replace the old three men in a kayak. We disappeared in the end with one person not being going to it anymore. Yeah, and then we had ladies on and it all got a bit messy.
But it was a great success. You know, we had on average more than 1,000 listeners. We had listeners in 35 countries and... You know, I thought that was pretty impressive.
Yeah, I'm just hoping that actually you guys out there listening will enjoy half as much as we enjoy making it, because I think it's been fascinating, actually, to be honest with you, in terms of
this new thing will be great. You have more platforms, iTunes, Spotify, YouTube, you know. This will be great.
Yeah, I'm just also hoping that technology-wise we'll survive. We're both a little bit like dinosaurs when it comes to actually sorting out the technology.
Are you saying men 50 don't really have
Move on. So first of all, winter is almost over, and the big thing for me in terms of reasons to be cheerful is that we can go kayaking again.
Exactly, and that will be great, you know.
Yeah, the only problem I've got is when I want to go out kayaking, I have this completely irrational, crazy fear.
Tell me.
Of sharks.
Sharks?
Sharks. And every time I go out there, even though sharks have been around for 450 million years, every time I go out there, I keep thinking when I'm on the kayak, there's a shark going to come out of the water and take me out. Which is ridiculous, because did you know that there are more coconuts dropping on people's heads that kill them every year, and actually more cows that kill people than sharks?
So irrational fear?
Completely, completely irrational fear.
Yeah.
What's more, you're twice as likely to be killed by a vending sheet machine than you are from a shark. And coming from, you know, farming background, nobody's about the cows, don't care about coconuts, and I'm always buying something out of a vending machine. So it's just irrational, completely crazy. But I think it's partly due to the news, sensationalism around sharks. Yeah. And, you know, whilst a man dying from being electrocuted from a vending machine, you'd never hear of it, you'll hear about every shark attack. And this leads me slightly on to what we really want to do in this podcast. That is, we really want to look past all the sensationalism, past all the sound bites, and we want to try and understand from the information and statistics available there, what is really going on in the world. So I think it's fair to say that both Tom and myself spend an inordinate amount of time Googling things, looking at charts, looking at UN numbers, big data, and we try and work out from there what is really going on. So, Tom, what reasons do you have to be cheerful at the moment?
Well, first of all, it's difficult to be cheerful these days. You have the war in Ukraine, you have climate crisis, everything you read about is so negative. But as you say, we have digged into figures and we see that there are, on a big perspective, so many positive things going on in the world right now. You have falling fertility rates, you have child mortality rates going down. One thing I saw, which is very interesting and very good, is that now that we have abundance of food. Food production is going up, and that is interesting. And that was not always the case. I studied economics a long time ago, and there was always referring to Thomas Malthus, the British economist, who said in the 1700s that there will be mass starvations coming up, because at that time, with industrialization, populations were rising, and they were rising dramatically. Food production, he said, cannot cope with this rising populations, and that will mean that in some time, there will be not enough food, there will be starvation, and populations will go down again. And that's how the world has been for tens of thousands of years. If you look at populations, sizes, you know, going back, you know, millennia, you will see that it's been extremely stable. And then something starts to change around 1800s. And these days you have exponential population growth. Today we are 8 billion people. In 2050, 2060, we will be 10 billion people. But still, starvation is going down. Fewer people die of starvation than any time previously in world history.
But what's the game changer there? Is it nitrates, fertilizer, packaging? Is it, is it all the genes which they've managed now to change that, you know, strawberries are larger, chickens are bigger? What's the game changer there? Is that all the above?
All sorts of things, but I think technology is important. You have new crops. You have crops that you can grow in, you know, drier climates. You have things as aquaculture. You can now grow salmon, fish, in containers. You have energy sources. It's possible to transport food, you know, from one part of the world to another part of the world, much easier, cheaper. So in that way, you have much more food than you used to have just decades ago. So that whole theory that we would not being able to cope with population growth simply hasn't been true. And if you look at poverty rates and starvation, you will see that it's going down and dramatically. So never has so few people died of starvation as these days.
So a cracking reason to be cheerful.
Indeed, yeah, absolutely.
Exactly. So mine is much the same vein, actually, made us much the same sort of subject. It's that child mortality continues to fall. Now, I've always been fascinated by a gentleman called Hans Rosling, which is a Swedish sociologist. Unfortunately, he died a few years ago. And he half wrote a book, which was completed afterwards by his son, I believe, called Factfulness.
It's a brilliant book.
Yeah. You've read it. It's an amazing book, and I'd really recommend anybody to have a look at it. But I remembered well when he challenged the Danish journalist Adam Holm about the pessimism of newspapers and news outlets, and the fact that actually the world is really getting better. And he cited all the time about child mortality numbers. He's done a few TED Talks, so if you Google those, they're amazing. And if you look at what child mortality has happened since 1800 to 2016, which I've got the numbers here, they've absolutely plummeted. More than a century ago, child mortality rates still exceeded 10%, which is huge if you think about it. And that was even in rich countries like US and the UK. But thanks to modern medicine and much better public safety in general, the number has been reduced to almost zero in rich countries. And even places like Brazil and even parts of Africa, actually, they're doing pretty well on that front. Child deaths per annum at the turn of this century now, in the year 2000, according to the Gates Foundation, were as high as 10 million still. But now, even already, they've come down to below 5 million and are still dropping. I think vaccines are a huge game changer in that respect. But it's very interesting that world child death rates are now as low as 5% in most of the developing world. And in rich world states, they're well below 1%. Also, child labour rates are also falling. So I think all of that is massively positive.
Very positive. It's one of those things you don't really hear much about. Another thing I found out was poverty rates. You always have the impression that the amount of poor people in the world is very high. And, you know, when I think of, you know, Africa, I have these images of, you know, people with big stomachs and, you know, poverty and, you know, it's all misery. But if you look at the figures, you know, even in Africa, people are much more affluent. People are eating better. They have more education. You know, more people have cars. And poverty rates are dropping dramatically. And that happens all over the world. Take China. If you only go back to year 2000, and it's not that long ago, you know, year 2000, you're talking 23 years. 50% of Chinese were poor. And the definition of being poor is having less than $2.30. Per day. So nothing. At that time, 50% of Chinese were poor. Today, it's down to between 1 and 2%. So it's been eradicated. And that's in 20 years. That's very impressive. So go China.
Yeah, but isn't it also, you know, very interesting in the context of what the population growth has been. Mm. I think we were discussing earlier that the population of the world in 1950, correct me here, but I think it was something like 2.5 billion.
Right, yeah.
And today we're at 8. So it's not only the fact that, you know, that the poverty has come down, it's also taken into a fact that the fact that the world has become much, much more populous in terms of where we are. So it makes it even more impressive, you know, how well the world is doing.
Yeah, absolutely.
The really interesting one for me, you know, with the Ukraine war going off at the moment, and all you hear in the news is war and war and war, is that conflicts are actually on the decline. And they have been for, you know, for a very long time. The great powers, you know, between 1500 and 2020, they were constantly warring. In fact, I read a stat that between, I think it was something like between 1500 and 2020, the great power, two of the great powers were at war with each other for more than 50% of the time, which is, it's huge if you think that. Half the time, two of the people in the world. And in the 20th century, it was particularly brutal with the two world wars and rapid succession. But the post-war period has been hugely peaceful, peaceful. And until recently, there hasn't been no war or conflict in Western Europe in about three generations, you know, which has had devastating effects. Yes, you've had the Balkans and now you have the Ukraine, but it's all very localized. And I guess a large amount of that is down to international organization, including the, I guess, the UN, the EU, you know, all leading to a much
and also
more
trade,
stable
I think.
World.
I mean, with people getting more affluent, we're not that keen on, you know, going to war, basically. We have too much to protect, you know. We have our middle class, you know, comfortable lives, and we don't really want to go to war any longer.
I guess the anomaly to that is recent conflict in, you know, between Ukraine and Russia. I think we all agree it's pointless, awful, horrific war. You know, I don't really understand why it's going on, except I guess Putin saw the Maidan revolution in Ukraine and got scared that would happen at home to him, and therefore he had to sort of, you know, bring out this crazy narrative.
But that is interesting. Is it just a madman, or is it, you know, the whole power transition, you know, thing going on? You know, the Western nations are losing, you know, relatively power to other nations. You know, China, other countries are becoming more important, richer, and they now want their part of, you know, world dominance. So who knows? I mean, who knows? But as you said, war until now, the trend is, you know,
it's massively down, right?
Yeah.
But if there is a reason with the Ukrainian thing to become cheerful, it's the fact that Ukraine has fought massively gallantly and very, very well, you know, and who knows whether that will change, but actually at the moment they look as if they're doing a very good fist of defending themselves. Secondly, the fact that the Western world has galvanized itself and have actually stuck together. I think Putin kind of assumed that we would get bored of it and then all of these people would actually, you know, back away from it. But if you looked at, you know, the largest donors of military aid into the Ukraine over the last few years, I mean, the US massively, massively leads the pack with 46 billion. But actually the UK comes second at, you know, 5.1 billion, European Union at 3.3. So I think the UK, as a, from a population point of view, has done massively well. And then if you look at how much people like Poland have put in, Poland have put in $2.5 billion, which is the same amount as actually Germany has done. So I thought that was very interesting in terms
of,
you know, the fact that the Western world has glued together and has actually done as well as it has.
Well, it did surprise me because I, you know, if you look back to, you know, Crimea, how easily the Russians, you know, took over that part of Ukraine, and there were not that many sanctions, you know, and Western nations were very, you know, uncertain, you know, what to do and so on. And, you know, but now it's a completely different picture.
From a Norwegian standpoint, I also read recently from Reuters that Norway's estimated tax revenue from the oil and gas industry rose by 200% last year to a record 89.3 billion. That's almost three times the previous record. So if you're Norwegian, I guess that's a really good reason to be cheerful.
Yeah, fill up those coffers, you know, so
Yeah, but I was a bit shocked, if I'm honest with you, when I saw the Reuters also reporting that of the additional $44 billion that the Norway was up year by year. It only contributed 0.6 billion of military aid to the Ukraine to date, according to the BBC numbers. Your Prime Minister Sture promised, I think, $7.5 billion of aid over the next 5 years to the Ukraine, so half in military and half in humanitarian. And whilst at this first glance you think, yeah, wow, on a population per population basis, that's a huge number, it does feel all of a sudden a bit paltry when you compare it to the 44 billion which Norway's actually made from the additional prices in gas and oil.
Absolutely.
So, you know, come on, Norway, you need to be a little bit better, I think, in that respect.
Yeah. All you listeners in Norway, you know, keep on pushing, you know,
keep pushing
our government to
yeah.
give more of that money away. Ukrainians deserve it.
So natural disasters, Tom, you were talking about this earlier as well a little bit.
Yeah, that was another thing that surprised me because I thought, you know, earthquakes, there will all be earthquakes, there will all be flooding, there will always be, you know, massive deaths, you know, from these accidents. You have fires in California, Australia and so on. But if you look at the figures, if you see the effects on how many people who die from natural disasters, it's actually falling even there. Take the floods in Pakistan. Not that many people died compared to similar floods, you know, previous in history. The same with the earthquake in Turkey, Syria, that happened just recently. Yes, people died. Many people died because there were, you know, buildings made not according to modern standards. But if you look back in time, if you look at figures from the early 19th century, for example, you see that deaths from earthquakes are massively higher than what you've seen in recent decades.
And again, so, it's a function, I would guess, of people getting out of poverty, isn't it? Because, you know, we hear about climate change and clearly it's happening. You know, it's terrible that we're having worse storms and these floodings are happening. But as you say, if you look at the facts, the number of people dying are actually coming down almost
absolutely
every year.
So you have better buildings, you have new technologies, it's now possible to inform people, you know, on phones and so on, that flood is coming, get away. So we have all these things that prepare people, you know, for accidents and natural disasters.
Now then, I'm gonna blow your mind away here.
Okay,
I've
tell
got
me
a massively interesting one for you. How could you ever make something to be cheerful from plastic pollution? I think with great difficulty, wouldn't you agree?
Because that must be a disastrous area. Everything I've seen, all the figures I've seen on that area is that plastic manufacturing and waste is going up dramatically.
It's a horror.
Now, so anything positive on that front?
Hugely positive.
Really?
I'll come on to it. So what I recently looked at was a pictorial which was done by Luis Lugas Vicascano. I think I'm saying his right name right. They're probably butchering it. There was a group of guys who actually, under a gentleman called Mr. Meyer, Lorenz Meyer, and they published recently, literally in the last couple of weeks, a big report about who are the highest ocean plastic waste polluters in the world. And he looked at all the rivers in the world going out into the sea and actually managed to see how much plastic is coming out of all these rivers into the sea. And they produced it in, I think it was science.org, the publication. And what was seriously, seriously interesting, was out of about a billion metric tons in a year of plastic which goes into the sea, and that's out of a total of 67 billion tons of plastic are actually produced every year. And out of that, the amount which ends up in the sea is 1 billion metric tons. Bear with me, I'm trying to get the numbers right. So 83% of all that billion tons is coming from 10 countries.
8 out of 10.
So 17%.
Just 10 countries.
Yeah, so 17% of that is all the others.
Okay.
And 83% of the 1 billion is actually coming from 10 countries.
Right.
And
is it and the
you
biggest
would not
countries
believe,
in the world?
No,
like China,
you'd not believe who the top three are.
Okay.
Number one
you're
is Philippines, which is a third of the total pollution. With a population of what, 100 million people?
100 million, about that,
Number two is India, which is understandable because they've got 1.4 billion people and growing, and also it's particularly poor.
Yeah.
Number three, which really surprised me, was Malaysia.
Malaysia, okay.
With a population of what, 33 million people. So between those three countries, they produce literally half. Now, the thing I thought was, whoa, where's China?
Yeah.
And when I looked through the numbers, I actually Googled the numbers back in 2 decades ago, and China at the time was polluting three times more than anywhere else. They were like way ahead of the game in terms of how much they were polluting. But the good news, and the reason to be cheerful, is twofold. A, China has really cleaned up its act.
Right.
It currently only pollutes something like 6-7% of the plastic going into the seas from China or from Chinese rivers.
Mm-hmm.
The second reason to be really cheerful, I think, is that if we could concentrate our education on those 10 countries, then we could eradicate a large amount of the pollution, of the plastic pollution going into the sea.
That's a reason to be positive.
And I thought that was a huge reason to be positive.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Fascinating fact, yeah. I didn't know that. I always thought the Chinese were worst in class, you know. But again, go China. I'm very happy. So if any Chinese, you know, listeners or viewers out there, you know, keep on, you know, doing all the progress that you are doing.
So on a lighter note, being short and a little bit porky, it made me very happy that we are, as humanity, getting much, much taller.
Okay.
You see from my two boys, actually, they're both over 6 foot and massive. They made me look very small. Interesting fact that the tallest people in the world at the moment are Dutchmen. Now, they have an average height of 182.5 centimetres. And strangely, milk was cited as being the key growth factor there. Right. As before the Second World War, Dutch males were much smaller than Americans, but post-1950, US milk consumption absolutely plummeted, whilst Netherlands actually rose.
Right.
And what the other side of the scale was also equally interesting, again, stupid facts, probably not much to be cheerful about, but more interesting facts, was that Japanese 18-year-old males averaged 160 centimetres in the 1900s, but now average 172.6 centimetres in 2020.
Interesting.
Isn't that interesting?
That is.
All
that
down
is.
To better nutrition, I guess. That is a reason to be cheerful, I think.
Yeah. So I guess when your mother said, you know, drink up your milk, it was, you know, she was right, you know. She wanted you to get taller, right?
Yeah. And even people like me are getting more beautiful. You know, we're getting fixed teeth, clear skin, etc.
Isn't that good?
Yeah, for me personally, the other reason which made me massively cheerful this week was, you know, you read about all these languages disappearing in the world, and I always get so sad about it. But there are still over 6,000 languages in the world.
Right.
That's a colossal number if you think about it. The downside, of course, is that I guess few people speak each of the smaller languages and the more endangered languages. Mm-hmm. But at least today, you know, there are ways today of recording these, of keeping them for posterity. So many languages are currently endangered, and there's so many that actually Welsh, which is my native language, is in the top 7%, would you believe, when it comes to the number of people speaking the language.
All right. Yeah, brilliant.
Go Wales. Yeah.
I say, yeah.
Even better, Duolingo has come out with numbers suggesting that there are about 1.62 million people using the app to learn Welsh, as against to about 538,000 people who actually speak Welsh fluently on a day-to-day basis. Exactly. So reasons to be cheerful.
Oh, again, another reason, huh?
Yeah.
Hmm. So twice as many people learning language as actually are speaking it.
Yeah, and then if you look at Scots Gaelic, if you want to get down that rabbit hole, then there's actually 400,000 people learning Scots Gaelic on Duolingo, which is 10 times the number of those who speak language day-to-day.
Wow.
So in conclusion, we really do have a myriad of reasons to be cheerful. You know, and the other thing I've learned is that ultimately, when you look at things being very bad, as the press keeps basically putting them out there, they're not quite as bad as anybody ever thinks.
True.
Consequently, when, you know, things are full of hubris, they're also not quite as good as everybody ever thinks. So I think we have a lot of things to be cheerful. And you know what the best thing of all, Thomas, is about things to be cheerful?
Tell me.
Better podcasts.
All right. That's a good one, huh? So we live longer lives. More people are being vaccinated. Fewer people die in poverty. And we have a new podcast, which is incredibly good.
On that happy note, you have a good day.